would that work? Anyway, I hope you enjoy the day. It is a beautiful one, and I'm sure that we'll have more along the way. As far as announcements this morning, I'm not going to. I want to remind you to keep those in the prayer concerns in your thoughts and prayers. And then also, there are several announcements about the church happenings. Please visit those in your bulletin. And about the only one that I want to highlight here is the noisy offering for world hunger. This bucket we have in the front invites you to share your loose change with that for world hunger. So hopefully we'll hear a lot of clinging and clanging a little bit later at the offering. So, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved your neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. And forgive us, and lead us, that we might live and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with the power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Please, our first hymn is How Firm a Foundation, 796. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Sovereign God, you have created us to live in a living community with one another. Just light the life of children, that we may reflect the image of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In celebration of Greg and Nancy Moberg's 13th anniversary, we will sing In Christ Alone.
The first reading this morning comes from Genesis 2, verses 18 through 24, and it's found on page 2 in your pew Bibles. Then said Lord God, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner. So out of the ground the Lord God formed every animal of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all cattle, and to the birds of the air, and to every animal of the field. But for the man, there was not found a helper as a partner. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed it up in its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of the man this one was taken. Therefore a man leaves his father and his mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Psalms reading is in chapter 8. Please join me by even in odd verses. O Lord, our Savior, sovereign, how majesty is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. When I look at your heavens, the work of the fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established. Yet you have made them a little lower than God, and crowned them with glory and honor. All sheep and oxen, and also the beast of the field. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Our second reading is in Hebrews.
Second reading this morning comes from Hebrews 1, verses 1 through 4, chapter 2, verses 5 through 12. This can be found on page 218 of your pew Bibles. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways about the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by a son, whom he appointed heirs of all beings, through whom he also created the world. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being, and he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Now God did not subject the coming of the world, about which we are speaking, to angels. But someone has testified somewhere, what are human beings that are mindful of them, or mortals, that you care for them? You have made them for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now in subjecting all things to him, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them. But we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of suffering and death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and my sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. The word of the Lord.
Our gospel this morning is found in Mark 10, verses 2 through 16.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Some Pharisees came, and to test Jesus, they asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. Here ends the gospel. You may be seated. Good morning. Right off the bat, I'd like to say a big old congratulations to Greg and Nancy on their 13th wedding anniversary. Yeah. Are those two very special people here this morning? Well, I was going to pick on them if they were. I was just going to say that Greg's probably like my husband. I'd bet a dollar to a donut that now after those years of marriage, Nancy still lets him have the last two words. Are y'all ahead of me? Yes, dear. In our Psalms, we heard, "Proclaim the work of his hands." His hands. A basketball in my hands is worth about $19. A basketball in Michael Jordan's hand is worth about $33 million. It depends on whose hands it is in. A baseball in my husband's hands is worth about $6. A baseball in Mark McGuire's hands is worth about $19 million, at least the last time I checked. It all depends on whose hands it's in. A tennis racket, it's pretty useless in my hands. I remember very well when we lived in Indianapolis, Indiana. Remember that, Bruce? You and I, we'd pick the hottest day because that's when no one was on the tennis court, and we'd go out and we'd try our best. The tennis racket was pretty useless in either one of our hands. A tennis racket, though, in Venus Williams' hands is a championship winning. It all depends on whose hands it's in. A rod in your or my hands may or will keep away wild animals. A rod in Moses' hands will part the mighty sea. Again, it all depends on whose hands it's in. A slingshot in my hands was a kid's toy. My daddy used to make me a lot of them, and we'd have the mostest fun. A slingshot, though, in David's hands is a mighty weapon. It all depends on whose hands it's in. Now take two fish and five loaves of bread. Well, in my hands, it'd make a few fish sandwiches. But two fish and five loaves of bread in God's hands, that'll feed thousands. Yes, it all depends upon whose hands it's in. Nails. Once again, nails in my husband's hands might produce a mighty nice birdhouse. And even in my hands, well, I can nail a picture on the wall or maybe even put a clock on the wall. Nails, though, nails in Jesus Christ's hands will produce salvation for the entire world. It depends upon whose hands it's in, does it not? As you see, yes, it does depend on whose hands it is. So why not put your concerns, our concerns, worries, fears, hopes, dreams, families, relationships in God's hands? Because it depends on whose hands it's in. Hands. Can they not give comfort, provide compassion, and even yield encouragement? I think about that, and I have a flashback about hands, and sometimes words ain't even needed. One afternoon, it seems like only yesterday, I picked up our eldest daughter, Kaya, from kindergarten. And we were headed on our way, our journey in life that day to Sioux Falls, South Dakota, for some errands. And, of course, we were talking about the day, and when she excitedly interrupted me, and she says, "Oh, Mom, you're never, ever, never, ever going to guess what we had for lunch today." And what we had for lunch, it made my day so great. Well, I said to her right away, I said, "Well, honey doll, you tell me what you had for lunch today that made your day great." And she looked over at me as I was driving, and she says, "Well, Mommy, you got to guess. I'll give you three guesses." I said, "Okay, I love games." So I said, "Well, give me a hint, honey." And she says, "Well, what we had today for lunch that made my day great starts with a B." And I said, "Okay. Starts with a B." I said, "How about bologna?" "No, Mom, we had bologna and cheese the other day." I said, "Well, how about beefsteak?" "Mom, you fix that for supper." "Okay, okay, one more guess." I said, "How about bacon?" "No, Mom, no, you give up, you give up." And I said, "Okay." I said, "I do. I welcome. I'll just give up, and you tell me what made your day great that started with the D, B." Well, very excitedly, she looked at me and she said, "Well, Mama, what we had today for lunch that made my day great that starts with a B was buschetti." I remember so vividly reaching my hand over and grabbing hers and just giving it a squeeze in approval. Not saying a word. And the warmth of her hand in mine reminded me that kids, like most any of us on most any old day, we need not criticism and correction. We need comfort. We need compassion. We need encouragement. In our gospel, you just heard me read that God laid his hands on them. God laid his hands, his strong hands. That can't help but remind me of an old favorite called the Master's Hand, and I'd like to share it with you this morning. 'Twas battered and scarred, the old auctioneer thought, and he thought it scarcely worth his while to waste much time on this old violin. But he held it up with a smile. "What am I bidding, good folks?" he cried. "Who start the bid for me? $1, $1, then two, only two. $2 will make it three. $3 once, $3 twice, going for three?" But no. Not a bid, not even a dollar. Then far from the back room, a gray-haired man, he came forward, and he picked up the bow, then wiping the dust from the old violin and tightening the strings, he placed it in place of his hand, violin and bow. And he played a melody pure and sweet as caroling angels sing. The music ceased, and the auctioneer with a quivering voice, quiet and low, said, What am I bidding for this old violin? And he held it up with the bow. 1,000, who'll make it 2? 2,000, who'll make it 3? And going and going and gone, he said. And the people cheered, and some of them cried. They cried out, we do not understand. What changed its worth? Swiftly came the reply, the touch of the master's hand. And many a life, with life out of tune and battered and scarred with sin and sun over our back bodies, it's auctioned cheap to the thoughtless crowd, much like this old violin. A mess of potage, a glass of wine, a game, and he travels on. He is going once, going twice, he's going and almost gone. But the master comes, and the foolish crowd never can quite understand the worth of a soul and the change that's wrought by the touch of our master's hand. Fall has fallen upon us, and it's October already. I don't know what y'all think when you think of October, but being a Christian to me is like being a big old pumpkin. With his hands, God lifts us, takes us, washes all the dark off of us. He opens us and touches us with his mighty hands, goes deep in our very being, and scoops out all that old yucky stuff, including the seeds of doubt, hate, greed, and I could go on and on. Then, though, you know what? He carves all of us a new smiling face. By the way, did you know that a simple smile sets just about everything straight? He carves a smiling face, then he puts a light inside of each and every one of us to shine for the whole world to see. So this beautiful morning, from one old pumpkin to the other, in our pumpkin patch of life, may each and every one of you have a blessed fall. God bless you. Now we will sing Blessed Be the Tie That Binds, page 657.
Thank you.
Would you please rise for the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace be with you. I invite you to share the peace. To make it a little bit easier on the, you may be seated. To make it be a little bit easier for the noisy offering in the bucket, we'll move the bucket back to the behind of the church, or at the end, and on your way out, you can deposit your loose change. Please join me in the offertory prayer. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our times, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love. Through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. May children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Holy One, you have raised up faithful leaders throughout history. Empower those discerning a call to ministry and all seminarians, that they may continue to be formed for the sake of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy. You have established a diverse and beautiful creation. Revive declining species, preserve endangered lands. Cultivate in us a sense of wonder for the world you created. Lord, in your mercy. You desire for us not to be alone and to live in a community with one another. Strengthen relationships between nations and peoples, that we celebrate and support one human family. Lord, in your mercy. You share in our experiences and struggles. Bless all who live with any mental or physical disability. Inspire creative communities, spaces, and environments that are accessible and hospitable. Lord, in your mercy. You have established and nurtured relationships that extend beyond those gathered here today. Bless members who can no longer travel to worship with us, and remind us of their continued role in this community of faith. Lord, in your mercy. Those on Christ Lutheran's prayer list are Bernice, Roger, John, Carrie, John, Elaine, Judy, Phillips, Clarine, David, Gary, Chris, Patty, Allison, Joyce, Kristen, Lee, Jim, Jerry, Dave, Marilyn, and Leon. You promise eternal life to all your children. Thank you for the people of faith who have gone before us. Strengthen our trust we have in you, Lord, in your mercy. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We will now have a temple talk.
Good morning.
Good morning.
What a welcome. It's just so wonderful to see so many people here again this morning, and we're grateful for that. A couple of things. I wanted to tell you about a rumor that I heard again the other day. It makes me sad. That's been going around the community that the ELCA is going to be writing a new Bible. That's not true. So if you hear things like that, please dispel them. Another thing I wanted to mention is that you may have seen in your bulletin and probably in the newsletter too that we're going to start a book club. The first book is called Be Determined. You can pick it up in the office. It's about Nehemiah and how he has been called by the Lord to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, and how it takes a village, really, to be able to put that all back together again, and the people that came together to help do that. I see that here. I see that with all of you that have just stepped up and helped to keep us all together in this community of faith that we are in. We've all gone through something that none of us had ever imagined. But there's an element of peace about this for me. One thing that I have seen is I have gotten to know so many more people than I ever knew in this congregation, and I am so grateful for that. That's a blessing for me, and I think that if we look at this, we can find many blessings. We have found people that have never done jobs before that they are stepping up to do. Or maybe they did them in the past and they had just retired them, but now they're stepping up again. That's what we need. One of the things that I think that we've done is we've taken advantage of our pastor, all of them. We rely on them to be the leaders. They're our ministers to us. They need to be preaching and teaching to us, to be helping us to understand what the Bible means, how it impacts our lives on a daily basis. We need to take ownership of the church building itself, and of the community of believers to care for each other. That is not the entire pastor's job. It's all of our jobs. And I think that with that, we have really grown in that, because I've really seen the ELCA group that meets on a weekly basis. So many people have been attending that, and they have found different things that they've been able to grow in. What a wonderful opportunity. So I hope that you can find that sense of peace and hope that I'm experiencing. I have visited with the Synod, and they are working, maybe not as fast as we'd like, on finding us an interim pastor. It's a process, and it's going to take time. And one of the things that we're going to have to do as a congregation is start asking ourselves, what is it that means the most to us when we come into this church and worship? What are the things that we're looking for from a pastor to lead us in that belief that we have and understanding more about the Bible? You know that it always, and I guess I've known this since confirmation probably, that there are certain times of your life that the Lord opens the scriptures up to you to understand them. And it takes a lifetime to do that. And I think that we're all probably in that phase of our lives. Doesn't matter how old you are now. In doing that, I know that the scriptures have really opened up to me in the past few months. Once again, making me more aware that I just took church for granted. It was fine if I showed up every other Sunday or once a month or whatever. That's not how we can worship. We do need to be able to gather as a community of believers and to be able to receive that forgiveness that we experience and to be able to profess those sins. And I think that it's just important that we remember how important it is for us to gather every Sunday. And I hope that each Sunday that we can see more people here. But it's wonderful to see you all now. Tomorrow night, the ELC group is going to meet again at 7 o'clock in the fellowship hall, and we hope that all of you would attend. I mean, it's a good gathering of questions and answers and updates, and how do we move forward? What are the next steps? Next Sunday, Pastor Stephen Quist will be here preaching and serving communion, and so make sure that you let others know that are not here today that we will be able to receive communion again. We all look forward to that, and I know that we're all in such need of it. As you may know, Sunday school started, and what a wonderful thing that we can have these kids come and join us. Wednesday will be our first confirmation session. Greg and Nancy Moberg have, the ones that are celebrating their 13th wedding anniversary today, are leading that. We're grateful to them for their commitment and their service. And I guess there is going to be a supper at 6:30, Sharon? Okay, so anybody that would like to participate in that too, we're looking for parents, grandparents, whomever, to participate with those kids. I think it's important that they see adults mentoring them and learning with them. I guess that's about all I have. The more we learn from the Synod, then we will update you with that. And thank you all for your willingness to serve, and we'll see you next Sunday.
Thank you. The blessing of God, who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. Our sending hymn is 542, O Living Bread from Heaven. peace, you are the body of Christ.